Welcome to Impact Thursday Night. We're in Holly Springs, Georgia, just about 20 or 25 miles north of Atlanta. Come join us. We have the contact information on the screen, email. Let us know when you're in town. Come see us. Thank you, Lord. I don't know. I guess most of you know that the Day of Atonement happened yesterday. I believe something switched, something changed. I don't know, but there's a stirring going on in me, almost a sensitivity tonight of the Lord. Almost a weeping, Lord, there's something going on in the spirit realm that I want to weep about it. And it's about people. It's about people that are lost. As I see people in the world, I'm hurting for them. So, Father, we thank you. We thank you for a sensitivity of the things in the spirit realm, the Holy Spirit, to show us so that we know that you're real and active and moving in this time, especially this time, the end times. As the Day of Atonement came yesterday, that something shifted, something cleansed us, something made us holy and pure because of Christ. Father, I thank you that let that holiness settle in this room on the YouTube. Let the people feel the holiness of God. What that does, it brings a sensitivity to us that we are nothing without you, Lord. You're our sacrifice. You're our soon coming King. You're everything. So tonight, Lord, whatever happens here, we surrender. We want to hear from you. We want to have freedom in this room and on this YouTube that whatever you want here tonight. We're not here to give you a show or anything. We're here to hear from you, Lord, that you tell us what the Father's saying for now, for this time, this evening, and whenever the people are watching on YouTube. Father, give us a sensitivity to hear the words of God. Sometimes that sounds so big, so awesome, but he wants to speak to you in that still, small voice. But many of us are so busy, we don't give him time to speak to us. But tonight he brought you here to hear from him through the teaching of the word, through the prophetic word, through the moving of the spirit tonight. There's a sensitivity, there's a yearning he's bringing in each one of us. Can't you feel it? He's saying surrender. You don't have to be about things, you have to be about me. I'm what you're seeking. You don't have to seek, I'm there. I'm there closer than your breath. Come into my presence. Come into the Holy of Holies. Because the Holy of Holies is in you. Repent this night, because the things ahead will be hard. But I'm making you ready tonight. I'm equipping you tonight. I'm filling you tonight with the power of the Holy Spirit. The dunamis of God, the dynamite, the power that's coming forth. This is real. This is not a game. Many people play a game with Christianity. It's just a title. It's just a bumper sticker. It's just something on their dashboard. This is not that. This is something real, living, alive. It will penetrate to your inner being and take care of you. Tonight he's going to knock out all the props. Tonight he's going to take out all your comfort zones. Tonight he's going to rearrange the things in your life that you can really know and understand his will for your life. There's a calling and equipping tonight. There's an impartation tonight that will be supernatural, that will change you. How many want to be a part of that? Amen. Lord, I do. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. We bless you, Lord Jesus. We worship you, Lord. Lord, we come to worship you whether we do anything else. I don't need to speak. James doesn't need to teach. We come to sit at your feet, Lord. I feel like it's a night of Jesus is going to give us communion. We're sitting around his feet. And he's feeding us the body, his body. He's letting us take of his blood. That sacrifice that he did. But he's sitting with us tonight. And he said, I'm drawing you close because of the times. And you don't have to be fearful of this time. I will protect you. I will put my hand and my guardian angels around you. This is the best time you could live in because I'm going to use you. If you'll start standing up and doing what I'm telling you, be obedient to the things I'm telling you. This is not a time to sit around and just pray. This is a time to go and do. Stand up and be moving. I'll get you to where you need to go. I'll tell you where to go. Do you not believe? Do you not have faith in me? This is that time that I've called you forth for a new anointing for the things you need, even now. Thank you, Lord. Partake of this song. Close your eyes. This is what's happening tonight. If you believe, if you receive, he's going to do this song prophetically over you right now. I believe, Lord. I receive, Lord. Can you feel it? Ooh. If you can't come up here. Thank you, Lord. You know, I don't want to waste the spirit there moving the anointing. And YouTube, I know you don't get our music on YouTube, but we just had a song about the anointing. The anointing is here to break right now, break addictions. If you have any addictions in your life that you're watching on YouTube, you can be set free. Close your eyes. Is anyone in the room or anyone that has somebody in the room that has addictions, alcoholism, drug addictions, any kind of addictions or mental or mind games that are going on, spiritual attacks from the enemy? Lord, I thank you that you're here to break. There's an anointing to break those addictions, Lord, and I know it's by your blood. So we plead the blood of Jesus, your blood, Lord, over this bloodline, over these people raising their hands, over if it's for them or their family, the ones watching on the YouTube. Father, we thank you that you're breaking. You're breaking addictions. Thank you, Lord, that you do these things. You did it for me, Lord, so I know that you can do it for the people in the audience. If we ask and believe and receive what you want us to. Lord, we ask you, break these addictive patterns in our lives that we came out of, we grew up in, we were taught, whatever way we got them, or a spirit of witchcraft or any kind of spiritual things were put on us as a kid. We break those things. We curse those things in the name of Jesus. They must flee now in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord. There's somebody watching this, a witch. I come against that in Jesus' name. Try this. Just say, if you're real, Lord Jesus, come and change my life. Set me free. Try it and see. You think you're moving in power. The power of God is so much higher, so much pure, so much holier than any of the things you think you're tasting of. It's a new power of resurrection. Fall to your knees and accept Jesus Christ, then the power of God will fill you. Lord, I thank you that you go around the world and change people. You're not caught up in this little building. You'll go and do the work that your word's spoken over people. So, Lord, I speak it over people. I speak it over our children, our grandchildren, our mates. Lord, break those things off of us. Bring them into the kingdom. I believe this is a recovery night tonight. If we believe, we're going to recover some of the family. Lord, I thank you. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Father. Thank you for the anointing, a heavy anointing. Thank you, Lord. Parashitona, speak in tongues, but this is a Pentecostal place, so Parashitora, Shunda. Lord, we hear you. We hear you, Lord. We want you to come and do something new and special. You've done it all, Lord. You died and you rose again. That's all we needed. But Lord, I know you have times where you come into rooms and the heaviness, the rain, the showers come and you cleanse us. I feel like that's the kind of night we're going to have tonight. It's going to be a cleansing, releasing, healing night of power and resurrection. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Father. I'm turning this down. Thank you, Father. Lord, I thank you that you minister to people. Lord gave me some scriptures, but y'all know them. In Isaiah 40, 29 and 31, it talks about what? Being strengthened by God. Who needs some strength tonight? You do. You need some strength. We all do. You know, I need some strength. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord. The words the Lord had given me tonight was established. And I was going to read Romans 1, 11 and 12, but we're established. What that means is we're strengthened. It's the same word in the Greek. God's going to strengthen us. We really do need strength from what we're getting ready to go into. We need strength. Some of you need a lot of strength tonight. You're drained. You're empty. But the Holy Spirit, through the teaching, through the Word of God, is going to fill you to overflowing. I sense there's a big bucket over this room that's going to open up and just shower over us. How about a cloud come in and just rain on us? What, you know, how many can believe? Amen. Thank you, Father. And I don't want to take it. Thank you, Father. I do want to pray for the new lady, Janet. I wrote it down. Thank you, Father. But she came with Mary. Thank you, Father. I'm moving. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. I'm going to pray for Mary first. Thank you, Lord. Lord, I thank you for Mary. I thank you for her life. Tonight, you're raising her up. I know she has a smile on her face, and she's a strong believer, and she's walking in your ways, Father. But I sense a direction change, Father, that you're doing something. You're shaking her up, not bad, just rearranging things in her life. And you're bringing newness into her life, freshness into her life, and some of those things that used to really get her mad and angry, upset and frustrated, they still try to come on her, but she's relaxed more now. There's a spirit of peace that's coming over you, a spirit of relaxation, a spirit of wholeness and newness and freshness. He said a path is being opened. It's been some time that he's cutting things down. It's almost been like you've been running up against something you can't get through, but God said, I'm opening the doors. And the waves of God, I just see you getting up on a wave behind you and just flowing with God. And he said, I'm making divine connections with you. And I think your friend here is a divine connection. I don't know if you've known her a long time. There's a divine connection. So I pray that you are a divine connection. I believe you were brought in her life to help her. Lord, I thank you for the anointing that this lady has, Father. There's an anointing on you. Do you know that? Do you want a more of anointing? The gifts of the Holy Spirit in 1 Corinthians chapter 12. Father, I thank you that you empower her in a deeper way. Impart the gifts of power, the gift of faith. She needs the gift of faith right now for the path she's going to be walking on. She needs to have supernatural faith to stand up and say, no, get behind me, Satan. You cannot torment me any longer in my family. There's faith in the room for you. We are believing tonight, but when you walk out of here, you'll be able to speak to those mountains, those people, those things that try to bring you down. He said, I'm cutting you free from some things tonight. I see him going behind you and cutting you loose. He said, let those things go. All they do is drag you back and pull you down. He said, let them go and go free and be with me for a while, because I've set you free. This is a new season, a new dawning, a new thing for you, my daughter, because I'm pleased with you. You don't have to perform. You have to just surrender. This is a time of surrender to me. Surrender everything to me, and I will give you greater things. There's things you've lost, things that have been taken away. And God said, I'm going to give you double for your trouble. Believe in me, and I'll show you my grace and my peace and my power, but especially my love. Do you receive that? In Jesus' name. Lord, speak to her heart. You're touching her heart right now, those scars. Go and mend those things in her heart, Lord, that she's been through counseling. She's done all the stuff to get. But, Lord, you can only do this. Touch her heart, Lord. I see you touching her heart. She's doing that to a few people in the room tonight. Even some people on the camera watching on YouTube. He's touching your heart. He's doing a healing in your life. Inner healing. Emotional healing. I see the scars. There's scars that he's taking the scars off. You're free. You'll be able to sleep. You won't have to worry. You won't have to fret. He said, I'm putting those things to death. I see a new flower coming out. You like flowers. You like bouquets and all. He said, I see a new flower coming out. Might have red on top of it. I don't know. God's doing a healing in your life. Oh, I didn't see it. You were hiding it. I didn't see it under your...
Kim, right? God wants you to know how much He loves you. You're so special to Him. When I saw you come in, there's such a deep, special love of God Almighty for you tonight. And He's coming in and pouring His love on you. He's opening up your mind that's been blocked. And I come against that double-minded spirit that has come against your mind. And I come and I speak life over your mind in Jesus' name. And I come and I call your spirit to life in the name of Jesus. And I pray for every plan and purpose that God Almighty predestined for you before the foundation of this world rest upon you this night. And your heart, precious daughter, your heart is open tonight to receive it. His deep, deep, deep love for you. You're His daughter in whom He is well pleased. Well pleased.
Well, Janet, the Lord spoke to me and He just showed me that you do have this great calling on your life, you know, and because of that, the enemy has come at you and the enemy has attacked you to try to take you down, but the Lord wants you to know that he's using that to preparation for this calling, that absolutely nothing will be wasted. And so I see you shying back, not wanting to remember, not wanting to go back. And he says, it's okay, I'm cleaning that. I'm using it so that you can help other people as well. I see him, you're opening up the Bible and he's just giving you revelations. And he's doing it so that you can sow the word into other people's lives. You will just soak it up. Go in your quiet time with God and let him just speak to you in a new way, in a completely new way. Go with fresh eyes. Just say, Holy Spirit, lead me. What do you want to show me today? And he's going to give you special revelations. And then I just see you going out and speaking it over people's lives, just sowing the word into their lives, just calling them into the kingdom with the word of God. So, may I touch you? Amen. Father God, I just thank you so much. I thank you for this anointing. I thank you for the calling on her life, Lord. Heavenly Father, just give her deep revelation knowledge of Lord Jesus. Lord, I pray for a double anointing on her life. Lord, I pray that you restore what the enemy has stolen, Father, and tenfold in Jesus' name.
Amen. Thank you, Father. Bless you, Lord. Bless you, Lord. We don't want to miss anything here. Thank you, Father. You know, as I was praying before, I just saw us people going from darkness into light tonight. I felt like there's a heavy darkness. There's a heavy darkness coming on the world. And we'll be a part of the world, so it'll try to get on us. But we can be the light. So, Lord, I pray for everyone in the room that darkness, when it comes, that our light shines bright and illuminates. And will be a signpost for many to be drawn to. Lord, I sense if any darkness in the room tonight, any darkness that's trying to get on our minds, our bodies, our spirits, any kind of depression, anxiety, fear, I break that off. I curse it in Jesus' name. To be off of us, to be free, not in my name, but in Jesus' name, the name above every name. No other name in heaven can do this. Thank you, Lord. Before I sense in that, I'll be praying for a few people on the YouTube. There's a spirit of death that comes on people, and there's some people watching that have a family thing that you've lost someone with suicide, and the same spirit's on you, so I curse that off of you in Jesus' name. That spirit of death must flee off of you. You must become whole and healthy in Jesus' name. Amen. That's okay, right? I'm seeing through that little hole in that camera. Okay.
Mary, Lord won't let me let this go, he showed me as Ken no, it's as Ken was praying for you, he showed me I saw you just curled up in a ball, almost in a fearful state, and then I saw you rise up as a warrior for God, and you were walking in confidence because you knew that you were God's warrior and you had on his full armor. And I believe that that is where the peace is coming from. The peace that Ken was speaking over you, that is where it is coming from. So, Lord, I thank you. I thank you for the confidence and the boldness that you are giving your great daughter. And Father, I ask that you use this in a mighty way for your body. Call her out to minister to those. Help her just be an example of what you want your others and your body to be in Jesus' name.
Yeah, before we go on, I want to pray for Mother Sue, and I want to pray for Rebecca. Her daughter's not here, but she's usually here. Lord, I lift up Mother Sue first. I thank you, Father, for extending the years in her life because of her mentoring, the way she loves other people, the things she does for the body of Christ. Yeah. But Lord, we lift her daughter up tonight. She's home, and I'm not sure if she's feeling well. I don't think she is. Father, we know that you can go and heal her. Lord, we thank you that she's a part of this body, but without her here, we feel her pain. Because when we together, we feel the other's pain. We feel the joy. We feel the pain together. So send your word, Lord Jesus. Holy Spirit, go and touch Rebecca. Touch her from the top of her head to the bottom of her feet. Lord, I thank you that you heal her body. And I thank you for the new anointing on Mother Sue, Father, that even when she goes home and lays hand on Rebecca, that Rebecca is just empowered and set free. I ask you to touch her other children, her son that I met a year ago, 2 years ago probably. Touch him, the anointing of God on his life, Father, the singing, the music, Father. Use him. He's not finished. He's not used up. Use him. Send him back out with a song and a word in his mouth to save the lost and heal the sick. Send him forth, Lord, in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord. I want to make sure that anybody got a word. I know sometimes we go, and I know sometimes somebody has words in here that we don't get. And she's looking at her Bible too. She might have a word. Do you have a word for us tonight?
Well, just for right now.
Oh, well, you're going to need the mic. Hold on 1 second.
This is from Psalm 71, Mother Sue, verse 17. You probably already know it. Oh God, you have taught me from my youth, and I still declare your wondrous deeds. And even when I am old and gray, oh God, do not forsake me until I declare your strength to this generation, your power to all who are to come. Amen.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Father. I want to pray. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Let us hear, Lord, what you're saying in the Spirit. Thank you, Lord. Pray for Press. Lord, Press is home. I know he has to work. Father, I thank you for this man, that you heal his heart, his body. You restore him. He's one of us too that's not here tonight. Restore him. Let him feel your presence right now. Touch him, Lord. Touch him, Lord. Thank you, Father. Pray for David and Ashley too, that usually are here, a young couple that sits right over here. Lord, go and be with them right now. I sense that they're in a war right now. I don't know what that means, but touch them, Lord. Touch them. Go and touch to them. Minister to them, Father. I'm not sure what's going on. Thank you, Father, that these walls don't hold you in. And I thank you for that in Jesus' name. Thank you, Father. And I pray for Nancy. I pray for both of them. Lord, I thank you, Father. God said, I'm well pleased. And I'm getting ready to push you in a different direction, higher in the kingdom things. Let the finances will start flowing, that you can go and do the things I've called you to do. This is for both of you. I see you going different places in the world to help other people to do things, especially one of you, but I think both of you on that. So Lord, I thank you for the people in this room, the people watching that are called to go and do things in other countries. For a lifetime or for a season or for a few weeks, Father. But I believe their imprint, their ministry will go to places in other countries that will minister to the lost and the hurting and women, especially women that are downcast because of the religious things that are put on them. I see you bringing freedom to other women around the world and even here. Through breaking things off, spiritual ties, spiritual strongholds. You'll break them off in Jesus' name. And it might be a intercession thing. You might be praying here for people in other worlds. That might be what I'm seeing too. But Lord, do what you need to do through them. They're both ready to hear the words, to speak it forth. And it's not about them any longer. They know that. They want to speak forth the revelation. And I believe God will give you both people that you see. in Africa and South America and Russia, in the Ukraine and Cuba, in wherever. He's going to give you countries and people that you'll see, and he'll give you a name, and you'll pray, and he might even, he will wake you up as strong intercessors. Lord, I pray for anointing on the intercessors in the room that are watching. This is a critical time to hear. This is a critical time for the intercessors in the world to hear. Let them hear, Lord. Let them make the time, the extra time, to hear what you're saying and start praying in depth and tell the people they need to tell to get these words out. This is a new season, but we need to hear. And give the prophets and all the people that speak the word over congregations, over the world, Father, give them the word to speak, the revelation, with the power to change things. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. I want to make sure this is a good shifting time. Right over here.
I just have a brief word for Laura. You know, the word that's been in my head for several minutes now is the word steady, as something that characterizes you. And I believe the way that that will work out is that in your steadiness, you will find yourself strengthening many. That you will be one who most of the time is giving way more than you're receiving from others. But at the same time, you are connected to the Spirit, and everything that you need for that flow will be yours flowing through you.
That's a good word. Write that one down. Thank you, Lord. We're going to, yes. Wait just a minute. Wait just a minute. Let's get a, hold on. No, but not without that.
When Meredith was praying for the black-headed lady over there, I could hear the word, I save. I save.
I save?
Yeah.
So God's going to.
That's all I heard was I save.
The salve, you know, like.
I believe God's putting I save on.
He's going to put something on your eyes to let you see better. In other words, there's. I'm taking that. I don't know if James is the one that really interprets things very well. He's taking some things off your eyes through this that you can see the spiritual thing. I sense a discerning of spirits that goes with that, because there's people around you that you think are good for you. And they're nice people, but they're not good for you for this season, because they draw things out of you, and they're sucking the life out of you. And you need to be real careful. Boundaries, if you understand boundaries. I think God's been speaking to you about boundaries. Read that book if you hadn't, but he'll show you. There's a boundary. I'm telling you, everybody in the room, everybody watching, you need to understand boundaries now. Because Satan will send good people to drain you, to take your energy, to get you sidetracked, to keep you off your path. That's what he does. And that's what he's trying to do to you. Thank you, Lord.
Yekorote mehete bohoshandi. Kedabaha rote mehete. Ledebo korande mahatu husite. Sarro nema. Ledeba karote me esete. Lato corrata ma ando osce. La de corrote me esse dobo oteba a rote yema carrote mi isse daba ato oscete randa sude mahando sharato mu uscete. Your head is being lifted up, for you will see what God is saying to you. The scales have fallen from your eyes. Your spiritual eyes have been enlightened this night. The Lord shall speak to you. Yea, I will speak, says the Lord. I will show you things, even in your own heart, and you will surrender these things to me, says the Lord. For you will no longer say, I am weak. You will say, I am strong in Christ. For know this day, says the Lord, I am the vine, and you are the branch. Apart from me, you can do nothing. Do not detach from the branch in this hour. I heard him say, cling to me like never before. Yea, for my glory and my power not only will sustain you, but this is your season of coming out and going forth. Do not look back. Do pick up your mat and walk. Don't pick up the mat and leave. You cannot dwell in this location again, says the Lord. Behold, I have done a new thing for you. Ask of me. Ask me, says the Lord. Is there anything too hard for me? But Lord, my heart, I'm lonely. God says, no, you're not. Because I'm filling your heart with my love. Yes, Lord. I'm filling you with my joy. And I'm bringing people your way, says the Lord, and you're going to pour into them because you are a testimony of my goodness. Says God, you are strong. Warrior, come forth. No longer will you run from the enemy. But now you will stand your ground, and God says revelation, truth. When you read the Bible, God is going to give you revelation of truth. And the sword of the Spirit has been put in your mouth from this day forward. And when you open your mouth, you will proclaim the word of the Lord. And you will see the sword of the Lord begin to pierce his enemies and drive back the forces of darkness. And you will come forth and you will take your stand in the earth and you will say these two things of God. He who promised is faithful. And God has the power to do what he promised.
Amen. Amen. I think we're going to transition, but I want you to remember now, I still feel like we're transitioning into strength. There's a heaviness, there's something that we're going into the strength of God. You just got to proclaim that over yourself. When that weariness, that heaviness, I'm moving in God's strength and power. I don't have to put up with this any longer. Maybe I'm speaking to me, but that's, you know, it's good for all of us. I'm going to let James come up and reveal the truth to us.
Testing. Here, I think I've got it. Thank you, Lord. All righty. Well, let me just open up in a word of prayer. Well, Father, it's what an exciting time that you are bringing us through, Lord. Lord, you've shown us the things that are coming upon the earth, Lord, and you've just given us a heart, Lord, that stands during this time and sees your glory and sees your truth. And it's exciting, Lord, to be a part of this time in history that Lord, you are going to make a mark that will last for eternity. Thank you for letting us be a part of it, Lord. I ask you to share more of your revelation and truth with us tonight, that we may even know you more, that we may understand and we may love you more, in Jesus' name. Amen. Anyone want to guess what we're going to talk about? Now, this is the last one because things are, you know, passing on into other things. But, yes, I have made it to part 6 of the days of awe. But today, this is, with joy you shall draw water out of the wells of salvation. Your dipper is joy. Isaiah 12:3. And, of course, I'm sure by now someone would have, you know, seen this. I think about everybody here has seen the calendar and all the exciting things that have been happening this month. And this part is the wells of salvation. And we'll be talking about Sukkoth, tabernacles. First of all, we looked at the things last week that have happened, and nothing disastrous happened week before last. And this week, when things really look like if there's something going to happen, it would be this week. The 21st, the International Day of Peace came, and they said peace and safety, and disaster did not come after them. Yom Kippur, we passed through it, and there's the life reset of a new jubilee. And all the events that have taken place here, and we'll talk a little bit more about the Muslim Feast of the Sacrifice maybe, but the fall equinox, by the way, it was not the beginning of the seven-year treaty, the way that Sir Isaac Newton seemed to have calculated it. And there was no CERN collider disaster. So that's all good news. And a lot of events yet today with the Pope addressing Congress and then moving on to the UN. And the French was going to submit a resolution to the UN on Palestinian state negotiation. This is the climatic day of disaster warned by the French foreign minister 500 days ago. Apparently we haven't had that. No asteroid strike, tsunami, or signs in the heavenlies that I've noticed. So all of these are amazing. And of course now we're going into the 25th with the Pope talking to the UN and the post UN session on adopting the Sustainable Development Agenda, and then we move into Sukkot and the last blood moon of the Tetrad. So this seems to be what's going on. It's been actually, I think, a quiet month relative to those types of things. There have been some things happening. I think you've heard today that over 700 people were killed in Saudi Arabia at the people coming for the Hajj, going to Mecca. And there was what they say a stampede. And there was large groups of people, and the word is they think someone tripped over a wheelchair, and they, as the crowd just kept pushing, they just piled on top of each other. Now, this is inconceivable to me. There was apparently no bomb, no bullets. How 700 people could die and another 800 be injured is still amazing to me. I just don't understand. But one of the things that I know is that panic and fear can create all sorts of things. And that is our real danger here. And I want to take just a moment to talk about that, because we've been talking about the things that may come up on the earth. And the fact is a lot of things have not come, which could have come at this time, but they have not. But it doesn't mean that things are not going to come up on the earth. And this is a problem that I have, is that there's many pastors out there and much out there on YouTube about what's going on and going to happen. Now, a lot of them are picking dates, but the fact is there is going to be some tough times ahead. And I'm concerned that we don't panic, that we don't fear. And I believe that pastors and congregations should be prepared for difficult times. And that troubles me a lot, because I have not seen a lot of churches preparing their people for difficult times. Yesterday, I was over at the survival store looking for a guy that could help us out on radios, because I'm looking for a communication strategy for us, so that, let's assume by some miracle, that the phone system goes down. Maybe the cellular network, or maybe some problem comes, and guess what happens? It gets overloaded. We've seen that every time. I've got a landline, but to be honest with you, you don't realize it maybe. Most of the landline these days require a powered device to talk on the phone. And you have no power, that goes down too. So we want to set up a communication network, and I just believe that I'm just calling forth all the pastors around this country and even around the world to do some preparation to prepare for the difficult times that may be coming ahead, so that their people can communicate with one another and so that you can still watch over your flock and help them. So this was a situation of panic, as best I can tell. And of course, we need to pray for those people. The Dow Jones daily chart, we have not seen a major disaster even there. As a matter of fact, we have seen this little red box that you see on the bottom chart is actually the top chart. We looked at that last week. looked like things were improving, actually, but of course it dropped off again and is continuing to falter. I might point out all these strange little gaps in here are the difference between when it closes one day and opens the next. That used to be about the same. But that means things are happening in the world, and the world is affecting very much how things look. Overnight, things are changing very, very quickly. But where it looks like, yes, we've had some drop. If you look at, this is 2008, there was a big drop. Well, this time, on our 7 years later, we've had a drop, but it's nothing like the last time. So why? I do not know. But what I do know is a lot more people were praying this time, and people like Jonathan Kahn got a word out, and a lot of people prayed, and a lot of this can make a big difference. So I can't say that, wow, we missed it, nothing happened. Nothing happened, maybe some things happened in the spirit, but in the natural, I'm glad. And it could be because of the prayers of the saints. I did want to still talk about the CERN, a Hadron Collider, because there's still more that could happen. And this is one of the things I just came across and noticed that back in 2011 when they had the Japan earthquake, it seemed to coincide with some activity that had happened in the CERN Collider. And as a matter of fact, it says that there's a bizarre speculation about what might be causing this back in 2011. It said other earthquakes have seemed to coincide with it. Last year when CERN put the Large Hadron Collider at work, within a week, you had an 8.8 Chilean earthquake, the sixth biggest in history. Now, after 3 months of halting the machine, they put it back online and they had the fifth biggest earthquake in history. Understand, this is 2011. This is not the last one we're talking about. So, is there a coincidence? Well, bringing it up to May of 2015, it turns out that then they're thinking, well, there's an unusually high number of earthquakes have occurred over the last 2 months since they rebuilt the collider to double and triple its power. And this is back in May. It's because they believe it creates a large magnetic field is how it works, and maybe that's disturbing our magnetic field. It's a thought. And then it turns out that according to the calculations which I saw, they fired up and set a new record bunches of proton collisions all at the same time, which happened to coincide directly with the Chile earthquake this time at 8.3. So I don't know what's going on there. I really don't. But I just wanted to simply bring that up because that's one of the topics we've been discussing. And it's something to pray about. That we know that earthquakes are going to increase in the last days. We don't know why, but we know that that's going to happen. And maybe this is the reason, and maybe it's not. Just something to consider. So, we're into the last blood moon of the tetrad. So, should we be concerned about that? Well, let's look into Sukkoth, and we're going to talk a little bit more about how this is going to work out. And let's start with talking about Sukkoth, and then we'll talk about the last blood moon as we go forward. And I use the scripture in Leviticus, and the Lord spake to Moses, saying, speak to the children of Israel, the feasts of the Lord, which you shall proclaim to be holy feasts, these are my feasts. And even though these things are happening in the world, we need to focus on what God is saying and the things that God is doing. And there is a cycle here that he has brought forth here in the fall. And the reason I'm bringing this scripture out, as I have before, is that you say, well, these are Jewish feasts that we're talking about. Well, I'm telling you that these are God's feasts. And they're in the Bible. And he is the God of Israel, but he's also our God. He's the creator of the universe. So I believe that these feasts are the things that we can focus on because they're things that he has established for us. And in them are some prophetic words, but there's also great blessings. So even in the times of trouble, I believe that this is an important thing to look at. So we're going to be talking about the Feast of Tabernacles. And in the Feast of Tabernacles, It is, of course, the last of these seven feasts that were declared. As we talked about before, the first four feasts were fulfilled during Jesus' first advent on the earth. And he did these things during these, quote, Jewish holiday festivals or God's festivals. So they're definitely ours. The fact that the Lord seemed to honor them, our Lord, is a sign that they are something meant for us to look at. And we believe that the fall feasts are a picture of what's going to happen as the Lord returns. So I've got here the second coming is the Feast of Trumpets at the sound of the trump. The Day of Atonement will be that day of the sealed judgments. I believe that when the earth is going to be purged of the Antichrist and his minions and all of those who are not saved. And then we move into a time of celebration called the Feast of Tabernacles, Feast of Booths, Sukkoth, the end gathering. And it's on the 15th day of the seventh month. Now, I've also included in here the Feast of Dedication, Hanukkah, and I'll explain to you why. And Jesus, by the way, honored all of these feasts, including the Feast of the Dedication. And the scripture in Leviticus, the 15th day of the month, you shall have gathered in the fruit of the land. So this is a picture after the harvest. So there is a harvest coming, and this is the celebration that comes at the last days after this harvest. And you shall keep the feast of the Lord for 7 days now. Why 7 days? It's a large feast, but could that be our wedding feast? It's very possible, but it is a large feast and is celebrated for 7 days. You shall take for yourself on the first day the fruit of the beautiful trees, branches of palm trees, and boughs of leafy trees. Now, where have we seen palm branches before? When he came the first time to Jerusalem, they thought they were hailing him to be the king. I believe this time we will be doing exactly that, and he will be coming as king. So we'll be yelling Hosanna, and willows of the brook, and you shall rejoice before the Lord your God for 7 days. So we have been through a time with Yom Kippur of repentance. But now on the other side of this is that cleansing, that purging that has taken place, and that change. And now we're moving into a time of great celebration. And I believe that's where we're moving. Now, the feast starts basically on Sunday night for us. And so I think it's going to be a time of great celebration for us. And I can feel the change even now as we move through Yom Kippur into the feast. Now, there is a time, I'm sure, that you look back after the judgment is sealed for all the things that may be happening.
On a previous slide, you had some holy days till October the 6th.
Yes.
How does that correlate with this?
Well, it's because the celebration starts and continues on for 7 days. Actually, eight, and then there's another holiday. They're all pulled together, yes.
So that's what this is till October the 6th, is what you're describing.
Yes, a celebration. So let's go back and take a look at how this blood moon relates to Sukkoth, because it turns out that this blood moon is on the first day of Sukkoth. And that seems to be what's created some problems. Notice it says the blood moon on Sukkoth sparks doomsday fears. Well, I want to deal with that for a couple of moments, because this is not to take away for what's going to happen in Sukkoth. The eclipse will be visible over Europe, the Middle East, right over Jerusalem. It's going to be a bright red moon. And it's going to be also in the Americas. We'll see it. This is on Sunday night, actually. It says in Israel it'll be at 3:12 a.m., but here it's about 8 p.m. Eastern Daylight Time on Sunday night. So this is supposed to be something very, very special. But let's look at this. Should it spark doomsday fears? Well, it did for this one man. This one man, Tom Siebert, decided, yes, this is the end of the world, and I'm preparing for it. So what he has done is he's left everything behind, and he's gone off the grid with 30 snack bars and lots of food, and he's moved 2,500 miles to a remote rainforest because of this blood moon on September 28th. So there's panic because there is a date. But I want to at least take a look at that, because that is yet to come. A lot of this came from the discussions about the four blood moons. John Hagee wrote a book about it. Something must be going to happen. And he said, something's about to change. But he couldn't say what. But let's take a look at the blood moon that's happening. It is a beautiful and wonderful thing to watch, but can it be the end of the earth? Well, obviously no. But let's talk about this. If we look at this blood moon tetrad, the tetrad is four blood moons happening on four Jewish holidays over 2 years. That's what this is. They line up, and it's happened three times in history, at least this history before since Christ. And one of them was in 1492, they say, is the event was the Jews were expelled by the Catholics from Spain in July 30th, 1492. But the actual tetrad started in 1493 and continued on for the next year and a half, or 18 months or so. So the actual event was almost a year before the blood moons even started. Now, in 1948, Israel became a nation. But the blood moons started in 49 and 50. So once again, the event took place a good while before the first blood moon, almost a year. Now, on the Six-Day War on June 10th, it turns out that the blood moon was within about a week of the start, the first blood moon, of when the Jews took Jerusalem back in 1967. So far, have you noticed that no event actually happened on a blood moon? And none of them even happened within 18 months of the last blood moon. So to say something bad is going to happen on the blood moon, I think that's a difficult thing to actually say. So now, here we are. We're at the last blood moon. So the chances of something being exactly on that date, the history doesn't even support that. We're way off of the plan that we would see here. So you can see that I am not as concerned about what's going to happen on Sunday night. Well, I think that, well, people have, you can take a scripture and make it say, you know, you can say, well, it says that the moon will be turned to blood, and the skies will be darkened and all of that before the day of the Lord. So they attempt to use that scripture. But basically, we're looking at a historical package that says, gee, it's interesting that this tetrad is happening during these consecutive 2 years, and that the history shows it happened around the time when Israel became a nation and happened around the time that Jerusalem was captured. So it's a historical situation. These are patterns out there which are appearing, and that's what we're actually looking at, is patterns. And we got to evaluate whether there's something in this pattern, but does it actually say there's a scripture that says, hey, on this blood moon something's going to happen? No, there's not. And people do use a lot of scripture to justify it. But as you know, there is a lot of things out there that people are saying, and the internet loves it. They just love it. So, yes, it's out there. So, I don't have an answer for you, OJ, because there is no, in my opinion, biblical basis, though you can, you know, bend some scriptures to say that. But in any case, if something is going to happen, the fact is it could happen anytime within 2 or 3 years. And to relate that exactly to the blood moons may be a little more difficult, even from a statistical standpoint. So the fact that some of the guys panic that on the 28th something bad is going to happen, I see absolutely no any justification for that. The things that we've been talking about are the patterns that we've seen. We've talked about the Shemitah, we've talked about the Jubilee, and things that make certain things special. We can't necessarily predict and say on this date something's going to happen. But we can also say that there are signs, and we watch for signs, and we go to God with those signs, and we should be prepared. So anyway, I just wanted to briefly then lay out what the real plan is that we know in Scripture. As Jesus was sitting on the Mount of Olives and disciples came to him privately, "Tell us," he said, "when will this happen and what will be the signs of your coming and the end of the age?" Well, he did not mention the blood moon here. What he did mention, though, is that when you see standing in the holy place the abomination that causes desolation spoken of through the prophet Daniel, very specific, let the reader understand. That's what we need to do, is understand. "For there will be great distress, unequaled from the beginning of the world until now." And he says, "I've told you ahead of time." So he's told us a key event. So if we look at the timing, let's focus on the events that the Lord has given us. So this is the scripture in Daniel. He's going to confirm a covenant with many for 1:7. In the middle of 7, he's going to put an end to the sacrifice and offering, and he'll set up an abomination that causes desolation. So going back to that, what Jesus said, in the middle of this 7-year period is going to be this abomination of desolation, which is a key thing that he told us about ahead of time. And Daniel continues on and also says, from the abomination that causes desolation and the daily sacrifices abolished, which, by the way, all these things are telling us something. It says here that during this 7 years, he's going to put an end to sacrifices. So you know sacrifices have to be happening in Jerusalem. And they're not. It also says he's on the wing of a temple, he's going to set up this abomination. Is the temple rebuilt? So there's signs right there that tell us very clearly from the Bible that no, we are not there. It also says that from the time these sacrifices are abolished here and the abomination of desolation here, it's going to be 1290 days or 3.5 years, which makes sense. 7 years, 3.5 years. Blessed is he who waits for and reaches the end of the 1335 days. He gives us these numbers for a reason. So we will not be deceived. So he also gives us another important number, 1260, which is 42 months, which is times and a half a time. 3.5 years, 42 months, or 1260 days. And he gives it to us many places. In Daniel, they shall wear out the saints of the Most High. He'll be given into their hands for this 3.5 years. Daniel, it shall be for 3.5 years. That he can scatter the power of the holy people. So there's going to be a power of the Antichrist for 3.5 years. The holy city is going to be tread underfoot for 3.5 years. And I will give power unto my two witnesses also for the 3.5 years. So maybe those two witnesses are going to be out there witnessing during this time. It says the woman, Israel, will flee into the wilderness for 2.5 years. Once again, the woman will fly into the wilderness for 3.5 years. And it goes on, power was given to the Antichrist for 3.5 years. So these numbers are very, very clear. God has given us a clear pattern. Now, I took those numbers and laid them out on a timeline. And I can basically say that if you go by the Jewish holidays or the God's appointed times, that there could be a 7-year period here. And if you look at it, 1260 days plus 1290 days just happens to be 2550 days. Well, our year is 2555, so it's 5 days off. So there's your 7 years. Now here's another 1260 right here. Why? Because Purim and Passover are exactly 30 days apart. So if you look at the time here, I'm proposing that this might be a possible timeline. That starting from sometime around the Simchat Torah, the very end of Tabernacles, If you go about 1260 days, you reach Purim. That looks like a significant time, because 1290 days after Purim is you end up coming to the point of Yom Kippur. And about 1335 days after that, you come to the point of Hanukkah, the rededication. Blessed is he who remains till the 1335. So you say, is this always the same? No, it isn't, because the Jewish calendar moves around and there's always different times between these dates. So I said, well, what does it look like if we happen to do it from 2015? Well, if you take it from 2015 and you take Simchat Torah, and you go 1,262 days, you reach Purim. Now, from that point, if you go 1,339 days, you come to Hanukkah. 1,264 days from Passover takes you to Yom Kippur, and the 1,294 days from Purim takes you to Yom Kippur. But look how far off we are. We're 2 days off here, and we're only 4 days long here, and everything lines up that close. So could this be a year when things do line up? Maybe so. If you're looking for times, I'm basically saying there are patterns that are biblical. And these are the types of patterns which say all this rest of the stuff can't happen. Christ is not going to return. We know that until he goes through this pattern, because he's laid it out. So that means that, literally, though, there would have to be a 7-year treaty starting at Simchat Torah or sometime in the first week or so of October. Could that happen? I don't know. The UN's meeting. Anything's possible. But if it doesn't happen, then that's your time clock. It's not based upon blood moons or anything else. OJ?
So can it happen?
That's correct. Well, the fact is, it says he will confirm the treaty, but it doesn't say at that point that he's recognized as the Antichrist. All we know is halfway through, when he steps into the temple and claims to be God, at that point we absolutely know who he is. But there's no evidence that we will know, because everybody's going to sign these treaties. So we don't know who it's going to be just when the treaty's formed, because it says he will confirm that treaty. We just know that his name's going to be on it somewhere. We can't say that he's the specific person. At least that's the way I see it. But I just wanted to lay this out to show you that all of these other times that says Jesus is coming and this disaster is happening, there is a pattern in the Bible. And like OJ said, maybe we should look at what the scriptures say. Now, this is, I can't say this is exactly what's going to happen. I'm just telling you that there are different things that can fit these times. It's not even a perfect fit. It's 2 days off here in the first part and 4 days there, which is pretty doggone close. That's 0.5%, roughly. So let's move on and talk about Sukkot. So in Sukkot, called the Feast of Booths, the Feast of Tabernacles, the Feast of the Ingathering. It's on the 15th day of the month of Tishri. It's one of the three biblical holidays on which the Jews make pilgrimage to the temple in Jerusalem. It's about a sukkah. A sukkah is, at this point, they're calling it a booth or a tabernacle. The sukkah is intended as reminiscent of the type of fragile dwelling in which the ancient Israelites dwelt during the 40 years of wandering in the desert. So what it's there for is a remembrance of time. And for us, it may be a remembrance of the dwelling that we're living in right now. It may be this body might be our time. And during this time is a time of reflection of the fragile dwelling that we're living in physically. Deuteronomy says, you shall celebrate this Feast of Booths after you have gathered in from the threshing floor and your wine vat. So that means the harvest. the threshing floor. Could be it's that's your grain harvest. It could be the wheat harvest. That could be the church.
James, what is the Feast of Booths?
It's the same thing. It's just another name for tabernacles. A booth and tabernacle are the same. They have different names. It's also called the Feast of the Ingathering or Sukkoth. So. Yes, they're the little tents that you put up on your roof. But it's as a sign, and for all I know, it may be, like I said, our flesh. That's what we're dealing with. Because understand, he's going to return and fulfill these things. And it's going to happen on that day, and it's pointing to something in the past. This is pointing to something that's coming. It says, you shall rejoice. So this is going to be a time of rejoicing. So get ready to rejoice. That's what's supposed to be happening starting Sunday. If he follows this pattern, to me, he's saying, celebrate this thing. And he says, just everybody, your daughter, your males, females, Levites, strangers, orphans, widows, everybody that's left. Because when it finally is fulfilled, remember, those are purging. And that will be those that are saved, moving on into the new kingdom. 7 days you shall celebrate a feast unto the Lord. The Lord your God will bless you in all that you produce, in all the work of your hands, which I thought interesting. Because if you remember in Genesis, cursed is the ground, in toil you shall eat of it. So he's blessing what he had cursed. And therefore, he's reversing the curse. So we can look forward to, on his return, the reverse of that curse. A beautiful thing. I want to focus and just finish up talking about the water libation, because I believe that's what the Lord was telling me to share about Sukkoth. There is a ceremony that happens during Sukkoth, at least it did. Each morning of Sukkoth, the high priest, accompanied by a procession from the temple, went down to the Pool of Siloam and filled a golden pitcher full of water. Then the high priest re-entered the temple. He walked up from the Pool of Siloam, which is down at the bottom of the hill, up into the temple, through the water gate, and there he was met by another priest bearing wine, a drink offering, from the crushed grapes gathered just before the feast. So now we have the cup of the water, and you have a cup of the new wine. And through silver funnels, the priests simultaneously poured their libations out on the base of the altar. Now, where's the base of the altar? In the temple, right? So this is a picture. Can you see the picture of the water being poured out in our temple and the new wine being poured? That's what we can expect. That's why we can celebrate next week. It's the new wine, and it's the water being poured. It turns out that they celebrated it last year for the first time, well, since the temple was destroyed, almost 2,000 years ago. They did this in Jerusalem. Now, whether they're going to celebrate it this year, I don't know, but I plan on celebrating it spiritually, because I believe that this is a sign of where we are and what's to come. So the water libation ceremony, there's several things I've drawn from this. One, the water is drawn from the Pool of Siloam. The new wine and the water are both poured out together on the altar of the temple. I'm saying it's poured out in us. The water and the wine flow from the temple outward, and the ceremony is considered as a celebration and a prayer for rain.
Amen.
I think that's where we are. So, as we look at this, let's see how this works for us. There's scriptures behind this. The Pool of Siloam in Isaiah, with joy you shall draw water out of the wells of salvation. Amen. That is the scripture for Sukkoth. That's what they're saying when they bring the water libation out. The wells of salvation. In John, Jesus said it this way. This was the man born blind. He says, when he had said this, he spat on the ground and made clay of the spittle. Now, maybe he spat on the ground because the ground was cursed, for all I know. But he applied clay to the man's eyes, which I believe represents the sin. And then he said, go wash in the pool of where? Siloam. So this is another picture, which is translated sent. And so he went away and washed and came back seeing. The sin was washed out of his eyes, and now he could see. So I believe that this is a picture also. So you're saying, well, wait a minute. You're talking about the pouring out of the Spirit. That happened on Pentecost. But what if there's something else coming? What if there's something, another pouring out that we don't understand that's going to take place? Go wash in the pool of Siloam. And therefore the clay and sin was washed from his eyes and he could see. He says, it's going to be something poured out on the altar. Well, as we know in Joel, I'll pour out my spirit on mankind. I'll pour out my spirit in those days, he says. You're familiar with that? He also told Israel, do not fear, O Jacob, my servant. And Jeshurun, which is just another name for the Jewish people, if you will, whom I have chosen. For I will pour out water on the thirsty, and I will pour out my spirit on your offspring. And here I think he clearly relates the water and the spirit. And by the way, we're the offspring, aren't we? Aren't we the offspring of Jacob? So it says here, the water and the spirit. So they're related. And Jesus said it this way, everyone who drinks of this water shall thirst again. But whoever drinks of the water I shall give will never thirst. Isn't that what we just read? But the water that I shall give him shall become in him a well of water springing up to eternal life. So clearly this is the Holy Spirit. Something is going to happen. It says that this is to flow outward from the temple. Then he brought me back to the door of the house, and behold, water was flowing from under the threshold of the house. You know Ezekiel's river flowing out. This is what he's talking about. Where did it flow out of? The temple. What are we?
The temple.
The temple. So this is a picture of the flow. And it will come about that every living creature who swarms that place where the river goes will live.
Amen.
And there will be many fish in these waters. Everything will live where the river goes. That's the Holy Spirit. That's us. This is a prophetic picture. Zechariah. And it will come about in that day that the living waters will flow out of Jerusalem, half them toward the eastern sea and the other half toward the western sea. Once again, we're that picture. We're that temple with the water flowing out. And the Lord will be king over all the earth. So there'll be a physical manifestation even of that. Jesus said it this way, flowing from the temple. Now the feast of the Jews, the feast of booths, which of course is this feast, right? Was at hand. On the last day of the great feast. Now understand, Jesus knew about this water libation, and I believe that's what he was talking about here. Because he said on the last day of the feast, Jesus stood out and said, if any man is thirsty, let him come to me and drink. He who believes in me, as the scripture has said, from his innermost being shall flow rivers of living water. And he's talking about the Holy Spirit. So he took the picture there of the water libation clearly during this feast and said, they're talking about me and the Holy Spirit. Come to me and I will give you this living water. The prayer for rain. Leviticus. If you walk in my statutes and keep my commandments as to carry them, then I shall give you rain, so that the land will yield its produce and the trees of the field will bear their fruit. That's what we're going to ask for. We want to see this rain because this is what we want. A good harvest. And I believe that this is scriptural because in Zechariah, he says, it shall come to pass that everyone that's left of the nations, this is after he comes back, who came up against Jerusalem shall go up from year to year to worship the king, the God of hosts, and keep the holiday of Sukkoth. And whoever does not come to Jerusalem, upon them will be no rain. So can you see how all this pulls together to say, this to me is what we're going to celebrate in Sukkoth. Something big is coming. Pentecost was big, but there's something else. that's going to be coming. And it's something that I'm looking forward to. And I am going to dip out of the wells of salvation with joy. And also just to share a prophecy that I had a little bit ago, but I wanted to bring this forth. I think Ken mentioned something about this at the beginning. For today will soon show that yet a new day has come, not like yesterday, but more like tomorrow. For your tomorrow is my kingdom come upon the earth. Can you see it? Can you feel it? Can you hear it? Listen in the spirit and you'll begin to hear the activity in the heavenlies. Something big is coming. And all of heaven is stirring. Elijah is speaking and calling forth the rain, and the cloud is already on the horizon. Know that it is surely coming and prepare the way. So make haste to run before the storm. Prepare now, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Remember, a cloud hand is rising. It was as a person's hand, and the kingdom is at hand. Well, Lord, we thank you, Father. We're excited about what's coming, that we can dip out of the wells of salvation with great joy. Lord, we don't even know and can't even imagine what you've got for us on your return and the great gifts that you have for us. But we know that it involves something wonderful through the Holy Spirit.
Thank you, Jesus.
And Lord, we reach out, not like yesterday, but more like tomorrow, more like your return. And we celebrate and prophesy those things, Lord. Because, Lord, we want the rain for a good harvest. So, Lord, we know that you're going to pour out your water on those days. That you're going to pour out the new wine, and you're going to pour out the water from the Siloam, the pool of healing. And I thank you, Lord, that you pour it upon us and that it will flow forth, even as Ezekiel's river from us, getting deeper and more powerful with the healing in the leaves of the trees along the side, Lord. Thank you for this, and we're excited for this that's coming, and we're going to believe for it and receive it in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Ken?
Yeah. Wow. Can you hear me now?
That's maybe me.
I thought it was coming.
That's right. Was that a shofar?
Thank you, Father. Play a couple of songs here and guess what this is about. You know, he wants to come in and wash our temples. Lord, I thank you for the teaching. I thank you that your spirit is being poured out. You know, it's almost like, I don't know if any of y'all been in Florida or flatland where you can sense a rain, you can sense the rain coming. You can almost feel it, taste it, and it's way off. You can see it, but it's in the air. You can feel the moisture. That's what I'm feeling of the Spirit. The Spirit is getting ready to come and just drench us. Maybe tonight, maybe tomorrow, maybe next week, but I can smell it. You could actually smell the rain. It's that close. Father, we smell the rain, the outpouring, this new rain that you're sending. I've never thought about it that way since, but the teaching tonight, I believe that's what you're getting ready to do, but pour out your spirit in a different but better way. Not that the first time was bad, it's great. We've all been dipped in that spirit. We've all been filled up to overflowing in the Spirit of God. So I thank you tonight, as we come before you as a group here tonight, that you overflow. Let the Spirit of God come down and overflow on us. Let us drink. Pour out. It's almost like the roof in this place opens up and you pour out the Spirit. And the fire of God just sets on each one here, each one watching. And you fill us anew and afresh with the living water. We are thirsty. Lord, I'm thirsty for more of you. I'm dry and thirsty. Fill us anew, refresh us, strengthen us. Even now as we are ending this service, but as we go on through the weekend, let us pause at different times of the day to be filled with the Spirit of God. I thank you, Lord, that you're doing that for the body, for the ones that are hearing your words. So many people are not even observing the things of God. They don't even know what's going on, but we do, Lord. Amen. We see and hear and understand the things of God now. We want to be a part of your kingdom move tonight. We want to be the temples that flow out into the byways and the highways and the hedges and grab those people that are lost and bring them in. So let the river flow out of here tonight. Lord, let us continue dying to self, our own selfish motivations. We all have them, Lord. Crucify this flesh, these minds that we have that are selfish, if we're honest. Crucify this thing. That's a hard prayer, Lord. I don't like to pray it because you do those things. You're stepping on the grapes tonight. I see you in the wine vat. You're pressing on us tonight to make us the new wine. You're giving us a different flavor tonight. There's a different aroma coming in the room tonight because you're squeezing us. Squeeze all that stuff out of us that's not of you, Lord. So we'll be new wineskins, able to receive this thing coming. Fill us tonight, Lord, to overflowing with the new wine. I thank you for that, Lord. I believe by faith that we can all receive that tonight. But we all need filling up. We all need to drink of the new wine, the heavenly wine. I see it being poured out over us tonight from heaven, Lord. I see you looking down with favor on us because you love us. We're your children. You want to give us the good things, the new wine, the new things that are coming. And Lord, we're here to receive. I don't know, you might want to stand up where you are, to stand up in the presence of God, to receive the things of God. Lord, I thank you that we receive these heavenly things. Saturate us, drench us. Let a downpour happen, Lord, over us. Even if it's not visible, we don't see it or feel it, Lord, it can still happen to us. Lord, I thank you, you going around the room, forgiving us, cleansing us, making us whole. You're cleaning this temple out so we can be refreshed and strengthened. Amen. Father, I thank you that you're healing diseases in the room, healing broken arms, broken parts of our bodies. You're healing our minds of those mind things. Amen. Why not tonight, Lord? Why not this inpouring, outpouring, overflowing? Heal our bodies too, Lord. Make us new and well and whole. Yes. We don't have to have prophecy over everybody tonight. We can just be filled with the Spirit of God. And it will heal us. You will heal us, Lord. Holy Spirit, we recognize you. We praise you. We worship you. Because you're the agent that comes and does the things. A lot of people have a hard time worshiping the Holy Spirit. They don't understand, but He's a part of the Godhead. We worship the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. So we worship you, Holy Spirit. Come and fill us to overflowing. You're the one that does it. So we receive it by faith. We believe before we receive. Hebrews 11:1. Saturate us. We've heard the scriptures about the water coming and us being filled. We believe these scriptures because you said them to us. You proclaimed them over us. So I'm proclaiming the same thing as James taught it. Let it come in, Lord, tonight. Let it be a river all weekend. Let it refresh us. Thank you, Lord. We're sitting at the bank of the new waters. Lord, some of us got our feet in. Lord, I'm going to go around and push us all in the middle. Amen. We're going to be baptized in the water of the new wine. Yes. We float in the water. We jump in the water. We go into the water. We go under the water. Yes. Saturate us, Lord. I feel it. I know it. Yes. I proclaim it over us, Lord. Over us and our mates and our families, our children, our grandchildren, our parents, our loved ones. Bring the water. Douse us. Cover us up. Lord, I thank you that as we leave tonight, if someone in the room has a word for someone else, let them not leave before they give them that word. I believe somebody here has, maybe a couple of people have words that they're supposed to pray over some individuals. For the people that are watching, God is doing something special in your life. Recognize it. Believe it. Trust it. Taste of it. This is real. You need to get on board. This is real. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Bless you, Lord Jesus. I got to play another song as we... You got something, Lil' Jay? Come up front here.
Yeah, I heard the Lord say this tonight.
Yes.
He says, tell my people this, you have no power over things to come. But he says, know that you have been given a prophetic word tonight. And you do have power, says the Lord, to receive that I want to give you in this season. Yes. And God gave us a word tonight, a prophetic word. He says, he who comes to me, out of your belly shall flow rivers of living water.
Yes.
Then God, the Holy Spirit gave me the scripture. It's found in Luke 11. It says, if you being evil know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to those who ask him?
Ask you, Lord.
And as James was talking, I heard the Lord say all that he's been teaching about all the negative things that is going on in the earth, God brought a consummation here and said, guess what? I got an answer. And that answer is the Holy Spirit. And he says, I'm going to pour my spirit out on the dry land. But the Lord is saying to us tonight, I'm not going to give it to you just because. You must ask me.
We have.
And he says, you have power over this feast. While you're celebrating because in your heart tonight, we are believing that God is going to fulfill this prayer. That he's going to pour his spirit out upon us and the body of Christ. And what God has prophetically spoken to us tonight, that when he pour his spirit out, listen, the river shall flow. Amen. Y'all, the river shall flow. Amen. And it's going to get deeper and deeper and deeper. And what he says, wherever the river flow, where it's dead, it's coming alive.
Yes.
Y'all, we have been given hope tonight.
Yes.
Not just hope, we've been given a message of faith tonight that if we believe and during these next 15 days, if we begin to celebrate and cry out to the Lord and say, God, fill us with the Holy Ghost, and we begin to praise him for what Jesus did in sending the Holy Spirit, and we begin to thank him that the Spirit is the answer for the world, God says unto us tonight, I will do it. Receive my prophetic message, says the Lord.
Amen. Yes.
It's at hand. Ask me and I will give it to you. Ask me. Come to me, says God. This is not the season to run from me. This is the next 15 days. I hear the Spirit of the Lord say, run towards me. Yes. Listen. He says, don't ask for personal stuff. Because once the river begins to flow, you are blessed. He said, but begin to ask me for the fullness of my spirit in the next 15 days. And he said, did I not promise you new wine?
Yes.
And new oil? Yes. If you will obey me, says God, and begin to celebrate and believe in your heart that now is the time for the river to flow.
Yes.
The time is now. Who will ask? He who asks, the Father says, I will give freely. You says, just doom and gloom, no. God says, I laid it out.
And then I gave you the answer.
Yes.
Take the answer.
Thank you, Jesus.
And run with this, says the Lord.
Amen. Amen. Good word.
I was just going to say, just I believe as I get to it more and more that the sukkah doesn't have it has an open roof. And I think that's to receive the rain. And I just want to remind you that this water libration is a prayer for rain. And it says if you don't celebrate this, you'll not get rain. So I believe that he's telling us that this is that time and this is that season, that this is a prayer for rain. And the rain will ripen the harvest.
Yes. Amen. I think Britt's got... If you need to leave, leave quietly, but if you leave, you'll miss something.
What's your name? Can I pray for you, Kim? When you came into Kim tonight, I'd already... was starting to get a word from the Lord, but this tonight, you represent this tonight. This is for you tonight. Now, it's for everyone, but it's specifically for you. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, right now, I lift Kim up, Father. I pray that the living water that has just been spoken will strengthen her and infill her in Jesus' name. Kim, the Lord showed me your heart, and outside, beyond the outside an outer edge, you're very tender on the inside. And the Lord says, I see that. I see your heart. And my child, take away the weights that so easily beset you, says the Lord. Follow me, for I see your tender heart. Stay close to me. Come unto me, and I will give you living water that no man knows of. For I have many things for you, and there will be many things and many people that will be drawn to you. You will bring before me people that no one else can reach. So be strengthened this day, my daughter, for I am bringing the living water that was just spoken of to strengthen you, to infill you, to overflow. So stay the course, my daughter, stay the course. Seek me. Go into the quiet place, to the secret place, to the place to where you can only hear from me. Hear directly from me, says the Father, and I will give you the desires of your heart that no one knows about. In Jesus' name.
Kim, I just see you as you're letting these things go. The Lord just kept having me to pray for you, that you just let him go, that you just let him go, and know that as you let these things go and you're picking up the word of God, that that's going to infill you. And then I just see you delighting in that. It's delightful, almost like someone eating a cupcake or their favorite dessert. I just see you just taking it in, like eating his word, and you're just delighting in it, but it's filling you from the inside, and it's bringing great joy to you, and it's strengthening your heart. I see you just as not weak, but just of like lacking energy, just lacking something, and the Lord wants you to know that it's his joy, that as you partake of him and of his word, that it's his joy that's going to fill you and give you that strength.
Amen. Amen. That was good. Got some prophecy at the end. 15, anybody know what that means? In biblical? It means rest. It's good rest. That's a good word. I'm gonna end up here. I'm gonna play a song, but if you rest. Amen. We're gonna end up and I'm gonna play a song. Lord, I thank you. Let us leave here being refreshed, even if the ones leaving here do not feel anything. Well, it doesn't matter. They're going to start feeling things. Even in the midnight hour, they'll be refreshed, strengthened. You'll be able to sleep. Those things that were besetting you, holding you down, are going to be washed away. There's a freedom and a freshness coming to you that's cleansing you. So over the next few days, you're going to be set free of some things. That's what the river's going to do. It's going to set you free. Thank you for coming. In Jesus' name.